Hi, this is Tom Rhodes. Please join me as I scour the four corners of the earth to bring you interesting and intelligent funny people who will enrich your life with wisdom and laughter. I'll take you to Europe, Australia, all over America. I might take you to the peaks of Machu Picchu, the canals of Amsterdam, the Great Wall of China, or the swamps of Florida, and certainly the many, many comedy clubs and comedy theaters all over the world. Come hang out with me and meet the many interesting people that pop up in my life as I travel the world as a stand-up comedian.
You're listening to Tom Rhodes Radio.
Karate kick, baby.
Rock and roll.
Hey, everybody. I just wanted to give a special shout-out and thank you to all of the wonderful human beings who contribute to this podcast every month. And let me just read the names. And this is my complete, wholesome, and sincere gratitude and thanks to all of the wonderful people who put their money where their mouth is and support this podcast financially by giving some money to me through patreon.com. I want to point out that with the money that everybody gives me, I just bought the best possible Zoom microphone that I'm going to record my podcast with from now on. Unfortunately, this is the last episode that I did with the old microphone, and there's some paper rattling sounds. There's a few little noises that pop up in this recording, so forgive me, but the next microphone's going to be so fabulous. Who knows what extra sounds we're going to hear, but I was rattling papers, and there were some unsightly noises that pop up in this episode, but I want to thank sincerely Michael, Kristen, Corey, Mark, Tamara, Bobby, Miriam, Jasper, Raimi. Raimi just doubled the money that she gave me. Thanks, Raimi. I know she walks around Los Feliz with this podcast in her ears. So thank you so much. Thank you to Johnny, Aaron, Russ, David, Siobhan, Max, Andy, Andrew, Troy, Alyssa, Eric, and Jason. Thank you guys so much for believing in me and the podcast and loving it so much that you contribute money to keep this baby rolling. Because if it wasn't for you, who knows? I probably would have given up a long time ago. But it keeps me motivated, it keeps me reading books, and it keeps me thinking about bringing you the best possible episodes to enrich your life with wisdom and laughter. And I thank you all sincerely. Okay, now back to the show. Mwah. Welcome to Tom Rhodes Radio Smart Camp. Wow, I have got a hell of an episode for you today, ladies and gentlemen. It's such a mind-blowing time in human history that we're living through. Just the events of this past week, we should all feel fortunate and blessed, perhaps, that we're alive to witness all the amazing events that are happening in human history right now. We're at the height of summer, which is a happy time. There's many reasons to be joyous right now, and there's many reasons to be frighteningly concerned. But before we kick off today's program, I am proud to tell you that today's episode is brought to you by Simple Contacts. And those lovely people can be found at simplecontacts.com. I've talked about them before. It's a pretty wonderful, unique thing that they're offering. You know, there are a million things demanding your time right now, so contact lenses should not be one of them. SimpleContacts.com lets you renew your prescription and reorder your contacts from anywhere in minutes. You can do it online. There's even a vision test that you can take. It's self-guided. It only takes 5 minutes. And you actually have doctors. Where's the thing? There's ophthalmologists, I guess, on the other side of their computer that guide you through the test. It only takes 5 minutes, and you don't have to get the extra expense of going to an actual contact lens glasses place and get hit with these extra charges. You know, I wear contact lenses myself. I was afraid of contact lenses, which is kind of funny. I wore glasses for 10 years. And then about 5 years ago, I decided to get the courage and try it again. And it has transformed my life. I look much more handsome with contact lenses. And, you know, when I was wearing glasses, I developed this this neurotic Woody Allen tic where, like, after I would tell a joke on stage, I would push my glasses forward on the bridges of my nose. And I really disliked doing that. And that kind of made me force myself to get contact lenses. And it's great. I look better in pictures. You know, I can be active. I can run from the police. I can jump into a pool. I can do whatever it takes. But simplecontacts.com is pretty awesome. I've used it myself. You know, like I said, the vision test, it's only $20. Compare that to an appointment, which without insurance would cost you like up to $200. The contact lenses prices are unbeatable. The standard shipping is free. And best of all, they are offering a promotion for Tom Rhodes Radio Smart Camp listeners. You can get $20 off your contacts at simplecontacts.com/TRR20. And you enter the code at checkout, TRR20. That's the number 20, 20. simplecontacts.com/TRR20. Or enter the code TRR20 at checkout. You're going to love it. This is not a replacement for your periodic full eye health exam, which you need to do that every year, every couple years. I kind of push it to 2 years or whenever I do it. And fortunately, simplecontacts.com has freed up a lot of time in my life where I can just order my contact lenses online. So it's removed the stress and the hassle of having to set up an appointment and do all that other stuff that you have to do. So anyway, go to simplecontacts.com and they do any brand, whatever your prescription is, they can refill it. It's a pretty amazing service. It only takes 5 minutes. And if you need it, there is the vision test for only $20. But hey, if you use the code TRR20, you get $20 off. So that's like getting the free vision test. Anyway, check it out. Simplecontacts.com. They're lovely people, and I appreciate them. Okay, now on with the program. The French motto of France is Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité. And today that is changed to Liberté, Égalité, Mbappé. Of course, Kylian Mbappé, the star 19-year-old player of the French national football team, France, in case you've been in a cave or drove your car off of a cliff in California and you've been away from any news for the past week, France just won the World Cup in Russia. The soccer team, the football team of France, just did what Napoleon was unable to do 200 years ago, and that is be victorious in Russia. They played Croatia, and, you know, 4-2, pretty exciting final with lots of scores. I mean, France was in control the whole time. And my favorite player of the entire World Cup tournament was Kylian Mbappe. Handsome, young Nubian gentleman. And reading more about him, he's from the Bondi suburb of Paris. And, you know, they've had a lot of you know, I mean, it's just, you know, a few years ago, they had the terrorist attacks at the Bataclan and and people being murdered in front of cafes. And then there was the tension of, you know, Marine Le Pen, when she was running for the French presidency, of saying that, you know, foreigners were a problem, and that, you know, the Muslim immigrants were, you know, the cause of tension and hatred, and, you know, did not fit in French society. It was, you know, the same rhetoric that the right wing nationalists and Trump rose to power on. And fortunately, the French people were smart enough not to elect that pinhead, and they elected Emmanuel Macron instead. And, you know, it's funny, like 3 days before the final, Donald Trump is in, it's what an amazing week in American history, because Donald Trump was in Europe saying that immigration had weakened European culture, and which is a very racist thing to say. And the beautiful thing is that most of the team of the French soccer team are immigrants from African nations. Like Mbappe, his father was from Cameroon. Just most of the players were of African ethnicities. And Griezmann, he was a German ethnicity guy. His parents emigrated from Germany. So I'll talk about Trump in a minute, but I want to stick with the theme of the happiness that I gained from the World Cup. And, you know, I had my dorky wall chart where I wrote the teams and the scores and the advancement all the way to the final. I hope you saw the final of the World Cup. It was really great, and it could not have been scripted better by a Hollywood movie, the fact that it started pouring down rain right after the game. And the French players were beautiful. They were sliding around in the water. And when it came time, Macron was out there, the French president. You know, and I love the photos of him, like, just, he turned into a little boy, like I did. He's cheering for his team. There was these great photos of him throwing his fist up in the air. And then when they're getting their award at the end, he was hugging them. He's drenched in water, and he was kissing their heads. Just beautiful seeing the young white president kissing the you know, the brown and darker hued foreheads of the champions du monde. And you know, and I love Macron. I don't know if you know this or not, but Emmanuel Macron's wife was his high school teacher. They fell in love. He was a student, and people said it wouldn't work, and she was married at the time. That's a very interesting story unto its own. And then he went off to college. They said they'd separate, and they never lost that bond of love. And they ended up getting married, and then he ended up becoming the president of France. And you know that I'm a Francophile, and I love everything about French culture. And I think Macron is an amazing leader. And then him standing next to Putin and the president of Croatia. And it was cool that, it was interesting that there was only one umbrella brought out for Putin and Macron and the female president of Croatia. I'm sorry, I don't know her name. I was too busy worried about Simple Contacts to Google her name. They're all in the rain. And then, you know, just an explosion of joy happened in Paris and all over France. It was so great to see friends of mine in France and Paris posting videos online of the celebrations. And it was pretty awesome. And I'm very happy for the country of France, because they are the champions for the next 4 years. I think another winner of the World Cup, it should be noted, is the team of Japan. They had an amazing team. They always have an amazing team. But in case you don't follow the World Cup, their fans clean up the stands, the seating area where they were before they leave the stadium. And then Japan lost a heartbreaking game in the last 1 minute to Belgium. And Japan was in control the whole game. Belgium fought back. They win it right at the last minute. And the Japanese players scrubbed and cleaned their dressing room before they left. And they left a note in Russian saying thank you to their hosts. The Japanese team, they're always classy. They have a rule when they play, no cheating, no spitting, no insults, no foul play, no arguing, no diving. And basically, their rule is to show respect for others, always. And this is basically Japanese culture. It's all about politeness. It's all about respecting others, and that's their way of life, is fairness, justice, and loving one another. And the aim of Japanese society is basically to avoid anger and bitterness, whether that's in your heart or other people's hearts. Japan, you know, there's no smoking in public, there's no littering, there's no blowing your nose in the street. You never interrupt someone and you never raise your voice. So I want to applaud the team of Japan for what they inspired in me as a human being, just by the way they conducted themselves. Of course, my team I was cheering for was Argentina, and they basically stunk the place out. But, you know, anyway, we got a lot of things to talk about. So basically, that's my little thoughts on the World Cup. The overriding thought above everything is who really won the World Cup was Vladimir Putin and the good people of Russia. I think it has to be said that, in my opinion and many other people's opinions, the president of FIFA said this the other day, that this was the best World Cup ever. And I agree. I thought Russia looked great. The host cities, you know, welcomed people. Everyone was afraid of racism and hooliganism, but they really looked great. And Vladimir Putin had probably one of the best weeks of his life with the World Cup. Oh my God! Oh, and then the members of Pussy Riot ran onto the field. You know, I remember my favorite Super Bowl was the one in New Orleans when the lights went out for like 20 minutes, the power, and everybody said that was the ghosts of dead slaves in New Orleans making their point or their making a statement. Pussy Riot, the anarchist artistic collective known as Pussy Riot, had fake police uniforms and ran onto the field. They're probably having their fingernails pulled off with pliers right now. But anyway, I thought it was the greatest World Cup ever. And in my continuation of my praise for France and the people of France, today's episode is also... Wait a minute. I'm sorry. I'm skipping over the fact that Russia has been elevated to the highest status in the world right now. Vladimir Putin is clearly the king. And the Donald Trump meeting he just had in Helsinki, Finland. I'm sorry. I almost skipped over this to get to Alfred Jarry and the avant-garde movement. It's such a low point for the United States right now. And I don't know if you've seen anything I've posted in the past week, but I have invented a new term for Donald Trump. He is the urine pawn. And Vladimir Putin definitely owns him. So on his trip to Europe, he just criticized Theresa May and her handling of Brexit. And then he also said that the European countries were our foe. So the European, our oldest allies in Europe, are now our enemy. And Russia and North Korea are our allies. And at the press conference in Helsinki, some reporter just blatantly asked Donald Trump if he thought that the Russians were meddling in the 2016 election, and if he had anything specifically that he wanted to say to Vladimir Putin in front of the world right now. And then he starts going on about Hillary's server, and where's the server, and where's those 3,000? How can you bring up Obama and Hillary every time you're confronted with something about the Russian connection to the 2016 election? And it's just amazing. Obviously, I mean, where's the outcry? Where's the outcry from Republicans, decent human beings in the United States, who, you know, the Republican Party, when I was growing up, their whole stance was being the enemies of Russia. So now they're our allies, and our allies are our enemies. And it's, I posted a Guardian article on Facebook, and some guy I went to high school with said, yeah, he sucked up to Putin the same way that Obama sucked up to the sheiks in Saudi Arabia. Are you fucking kidding me? Even the brainwashed minions of people who call themselves Republicans are going to bring up Obama and Hillary every time they're confronted. Hey, man, that's the fucking past. Obama and Hillary are no longer in charge. You have to, if you don't see that something really smelly and fucked up is happening to the United States right now, and that Donald Trump is not only throwing us off of a bus, he's driving the bus off of a cliff. I mean, I don't think the United States is ever going to recover from this. And, you know, I'm a proud American. I love my country. But I never thought there were this many racist idiots or people who just cannot be confronted with the truth and admit to the truth that something really fucked up is happening right now. So the fact that you still keep pointing to Democrats and Obama and Hillary, and you can't find any fault in this guy, I think that's pretty terrifying. I think that's, it's a lazy comparison to compare him to Hitler. But obviously, there were other people complicit in killing all of those Jewish people. Hitler didn't do it by himself. And I can see that. I don't know, man. There's some pretty bad shit on the horizon if our enemies are now our friends and our friends are now our enemies. So interesting. But you really have to applaud Vladimir Putin, man. He's the ultimate chess master. And that video he has on Donald Trump of the prostitutes urinating on the bed at the Ritz-Carlton must be a lot worse than we ever even imagined. But Trump had taken many trips to Russia, so I'm sure they've got a lot of different video footage of him. And it must be really bad. And what did Putin do for Trump? I mean, we got absolutely nothing in return. Why would he stand there? The guy's supposed to be protecting American interests, and he just he discredits everything the United States stands for and says that he believes Putin when Putin tells him there was no collusion and that the Russians had nothing to do with it. You know, that's like if in the 70s when the FBI was investigating the mafia, they would have said, oh, no, the mafia guys said they're innocent. They're not doing anything. So why would you take the word of the person responsible? And Vladimir Putin gave him a soccer ball. And Trump, wow, it's beyond idiocy and idiocracy. As funny as that movie was, and I thought it would never be possible to live in that country, we will soon be watering our plants with electrolytes. So, okay. Now let's praise the country of France more. In January, I did a show at the Theatre L'Ouvre, where one of the most significant events in contemporary theater happened. And this guy, Alfred Jarry, wrote a play called Ubu Roy. And Roy means king. So the English translation could be King Roy. I'm sorry, King Ubu. But Ubu Roy. I've got things to read you today. So I've been reading this amazing book. It's called The Banquet Years. And it's the origins of the avant-garde in France from 1885 to World War I. So first of all, I want to talk about the painter Henri Rousseau. And I never liked Rousseau. He does these really tropical paintings and paintings of lions and monkeys. And I was never that crazy about him. But after reading this book, I like him. And I'm going to tell you why you should like him. So Rousseau he didn't start painting until he was 50 years old. And he worked for the toll service, the municipal toll service in Paris. And then he was married and he had kids and then he retired. And then he started painting at the age of 50. And then critics ripped him to shreds. They hated what he did. He was kind of like the laughing stock of Paris. And the reason I'm mentioning Rousseau was because him and Alfred Jarry were from the same town in northwest France called Laval. And then years later, when Jarry had money problems, he actually lived with Rousseau for a little while. So let me read you a few things about Rousseau. So in 1885, his first publicly exhibited works were hung at the official Salon des Champs-Élysées. The remarkable event is generally unknown or overlooked, yet it was crucial importance for his future career. Rousseau's two paintings were slashed with knives by spectators and removed from the show and put with the refuses, the trash. The year Rousseau sacrificed everything to start a new life as an artist, he met with public abuse of his paintings. We know of the event through the newspaper clippings he pasted without comment into his scrapbook, and his imperturbability corroborates what we can already detect in his painting. Somewhere in his 40 years, he had learned the quality of perseverance, seeing his hopes of academic recognition so violently flouted at the very outset. Rousseau associated himself henceforth with the newest tendencies in painting and was not again refused. So wow, at his first exhibition, people not only hated it, they slashed it with fucking knives. Boy, there's a rejection that'll surely sit with you. At this time, Jarry was a precocious young poet, scarcely 20. Charming, but eccentric, and not yet called up for military service. Rousseau was close to 50, with a long life of wars and loves and losses already behind him. Can you hear my pages turning? Poverty afflicted him. Oh, and then Rousseau's wife died. You know, he started painting at 50. Really humble guy. And then, you know, people think that he, like, took a trip to Mexico or he went to Africa, was why Rousseau's paintings were always tropical. But he would go for these long walks all over Paris. And at that time, the outskirts of Paris were still pretty wild. You could walk from the center of the city to the outskirts, and there was nature. And then also, Paris had probably one of the best botanical gardens, and he would go to the botanical gardens, and that's where he got the inspiration for his tropical plants in his paintings. And then he would go to the zoo for... So, I mean, it looks like Gauguin went to Tahiti and painted all those, you know, topless Tahitian women and tropical scenes. But Rousseau did this basically by going to the botanical gardens and the zoo. And poverty afflicted him as grievously as it did the laborers who were his neighbors. He always needed money for paint and canvas, and he tramped across Paris, his violin under his arm, to give music lessons. After the experience of teaching in the Philotechnique Association and with the prestige of Palmes Academiques, he hit upon a solution that suited his status as artist. He opened a school. In his doorway, hidden away in one of the lowliest streets in Paris, was displayed a sign: courses in diction, music, painting, solfeggio. Fuck, I don't know what solfeggio is. For 8 francs a month, he instructed both... Shit, okay. Let me pull up the computer. Let's take a little trip to Webster's Dictionary. Solfeggio. Okay. Term for solfege. What does it mean? An exercise in singing using psalmization syllables. The studying of singing and musicianship using psalmization syllables. Okay, well, good thing we took that detour, huh? Aren't you glad you know what that is? Surely that'll come up at your next dinner party. For eight francs a month, he instructed both the very young and the very old. Insubordination and doltishness in his pupils did not ruffle him. His art students have never achieved fame, yet a nice paradox lurks in the fact that he should have earned at least a meager living teaching a subject supposed ignorance of which made him famous. So people played pranks on him. All these other artists, made fun of him. There's a story in this book where these artists had a party to honor him. So Rousseau was like the laughingstock and the joke of the critics. They shit on him. They didn't think he could paint hands very well. They thought his people looked very stupid. They ridiculed the childishness nature of his paintings. And all these other artists played pranks on Rousseau constantly. So the guy stayed pretty humble. Through all the pranks, Rousseau's childlike nature never soured. He never shrank back into himself in the face of a world that tossed him about like a mascot, praising and ridiculing him, fetting and ignoring him. Perhaps his unshakable self-confidence partook of certain delusions about himself and the world. But he proved, after all, to be right. A letter he wrote to the mayor of his birthplace, Laval, reaffirms the assurance with which he regarded his work. He was offering for them to buy one of his paintings for 2,000 francs, and he was completely broke, and nobody knew who he was. And he had these great parties, soirees, if you will. His soirees were supposed to be literary, philosophical affairs, but there was always much drinking, laughter, and horseplay. Whenever the atmosphere became a trifle bacchanic, one woman and her four daughters with flowers in their hair would make a ladylike exit. By midnight, things were often bacchanic. Okay, all right, since we've got it open. Doo-doo-doop, doo-doop, boop. What does bacchanic mean? Baconic. It's not in the fucking Webster's. Okay, great. Thanks. By midnight, things were often bacchantic for fair. Perhaps old Rousseau himself, in the midst of the chaos, tootling a flute before the full-length portrait of his dead wife and dancing from foot to foot, tears streaming from his eyes. On my way home from this first visit, which I shall never forget, who wrote this? Max Weber. Well, wish Weber was around to... Okay, so... This is from Max Weber, wrote this. On my way home from this first visit, which I shall never forget as long as I live, I felt I had been favored by the gods to meet one of the most inspiring and precarious personalities of all Paris. Here, I said to myself, is a man, an artist, a poet, whose friendship and advice I must cultivate and cherish. By a sacred sense of privacy, he was shielded from the snobbery, pretense, and sophistication which was rife in the art circles of the time. So, yeah. And then Jarry stayed with him. Jarry's deliberate distortion of the world. Jarry, author of profoundly metaphysical and mystical works, rode about Paris on a bicycle with pistols in his belt and lived on fish he caught in the Seine. Okay, let's come back to this. So Jarry died, Rousseau died. And then... Jarry kind of comes to prominence after Rousseau had died. And like I said, Jarry had stayed with him. And let me read you some of this about Ubu Roy. This is his most famous play. And this is what put him on the map. And this was the big scandal. And this is what put that theater that I played in January in Paris, the Theatre La Ouvre. This is what made that place famous. And there was a near riot after the first performance of this. So this is why this is so important and why Alfred Jarry is to be remembered. Ubu Roy is a play by Alfred Jarry. It was first performed in Paris at Theatre La Ouvre, causing a riotous response in the audience as it opened and closed on December 10th, 1896. It is considered a wild, bizarre, and comic play, significant for the way it overturns cultural rules, norms, and conventions. For those who were in the audience on that night to witness the response, including W.B. Yeats, the famous poet, it seemed an event of revolutionary importance. It is now seen by some to have opened the door for what became known as modernism in the 20th century. It is the precursor to Dada. And of course, Dada, the Dada movement started in Zurich, Switzerland, at the Café Voltaire, which I went to when I was in Zurich last December. And I love the political aim of the Dada art movement is the desire to burst out laughing. That is, that's their whole stated aim for the Dada art movement. So Ubu Roy is the precursor to Dada, surrealism, and the theater of the absurd. So you see, it's pretty important. This inspired the whole surrealist art movement and theater of the absurd and Dada. That's pretty fucking huge. It is the first of three stylized burlesques in which Jarry satirizes power, greed, and their evil practices. In particular, the propensity of the complacent bourgeoisie to abuse the authority engendered by success. The title is sometimes translated as King Turd. However, the word ubu is actually merely a nonsense word that evolved from the French pronunciation of the name Herbert, Herbe, which was the name of one of Jari's teachers, who was the satirical target and inspirer of the first versions of the play. Jari made some suggestions regarding how this play should be performed. He wanted King Ubu to wear a cardboard horse's head in certain scenes, as in the Old English Theater, for he intended to write a guignol, which is French for slapstick. So he was trying to write a French slapstick comedy with this play. He thought a suitably costumed person would enter, as in puppet shows, to put up signs indicating the locations of the various scenes. He also wanted costumes with as little specific local color reference or historical accuracy as possible. Yeah, so that's the thing at that Theater La Ovra. They have no sets. And Jari invented that with this play, that that the dialogue, that the play itself is the decor. The words of the performance are the decor. And that's what I was told when I performed there, that the place was famous for not having decor, and that this play Ubu Roy had happened there. So Ubu Roy was followed by Ubu Cuckolded, Ubu in Chains, neither of which was performed during Jari's 34-year life. Of his later works, a novel essay, Pataphysics, is offered as an explanation behind the ideas that underpin Ubu Roy. Pataphysics is, as Jari explains, the science of the realm beyond metaphysics. Pataphysics is a pseudoscience Jari created to critique members of the Academy. It studies the laws that govern exceptions and will explain the universe supplementary to this one. So, an interesting thing about Jari is that he stayed fucked up all the time. He drank absinthe, he drank booze, and later when he was poor, he would sniff ether. So, he was trying to blend the world, trying to reach the cracks of the brain where you don't go normally. And that's why it's interesting to like read about him now when I'm sober, because like that's why I did drugs. And that's why I drank, was thinking that there were artistic nether regions of your brain that you couldn't reach without narcotics or drinking. And it ended up killing him. I mean, he kind of, you know, I mean, he was notorious. He had success in the literary circles of Paris, and he was this eccentric, but this lifestyle killed him, and that's why he died at 34. So I'll read you more from the book. This is, before I get back to the book, I want to tell you about the play itself, which I'll read you more from the book. But here's the synopsis of Ubu Roy. The story is a parody of Shakespeare's Macbeth and some parts of Hamlet and King Lear. Though the writing and dialogue is obscene and childish, the material began to express something deeper, an inner consciousness in a way that is similar to the symbolists, with many critics considering Jari a symbolist author. As the play begins, Ubu's wife convinces him to lead a revolution and kills the king of Poland and most of the royal family. The king's son, Bugrelas, and the queen escape, but the latter dies. The ghost of the dead king appears to his son and calls for revenge. Back at the palace, Ubu, now king, begins heavily taxing the people and killing the nobles for their wealth. Ubu's henchman gets thrown into prison, who then escapes to Russia, where he has the Tsar declare war on Ubu. As Ubu heads out to confront the invading Russians, his wife tries to steal the money and treasures in the palace. She is driven away by Bugrelas, who is leading a revolt of the people against Ubu. She runs away to her husband, Ubu, who has, in the meantime, defeated the Russians, abandoned by his followers, and been attacked by a bear. Ubu's wife pretends to be the angel Gabriel in order to try to scare Ubu into forgiving her for her attempt to steal from him. They fight, and she is rescued by the entrance of Bugrilas, who is after Ubu. Ubu knocks down the attackers with the body of the dead bear, after which he and his wife flee to France, which ends the play. So that's the play, basically, with no sets. And the character of Ubu is really interesting. He's a slob. I'll just read you. So these are the highlights that I made from this wonderful book. And this guy Jari is, Picasso looked up to him. And just picture this guy riding around on a bicycle with pistols and a notebook in Paris, drunk out of his mind, which sounds romantic, but remember, it killed him. And we can do these things sober. So at times, Rousseau's ingenuousness startlingly resembles Jari's deliberate distortion of the world. Jari, author of profoundly metaphysical and mystical works, rode about Paris on a bicycle with pistols in his belt and lived on fish he caught in the Seine. Which, it might be too polluted to do that anymore, but in 1880s, 1890s, I guess you could do that. Okay, so, and this chapter, I was going to call this episode this, the chapter is called Suicide by Hallucination, but I don't think I'll get any more advertisers if I call it that. So, Jari was what the French call a potache when he was growing up, which it's a mixture of vice and virtue, half brat, half prodigy. This French word for a schoolboy connotates mild toleration from the frenzied play acting of adolescence. His companions admired him, haltingly followed his lead, and hated him a little for being able to flaunt an unpunished arrogance. His conduct, which alternated between virtuosity and effrontery, revealed a terrible wrenching of personality in which an aggressive imagination struggled with an almost invincible timidity. The other potache of French literature, Rimbaud, could not sustain the role. He abandoned his career as poet at the age of 19 to become an ill-starred adventurer. Jari, completing his best work between the ages of 15 and 25, refused ever to come to terms with the world. His life and his work united in a single threat to the equilibrium of human nature. He died at 34 in a gradual suicide by poverty, drink, and violating identity. Okay, gotta turn the light on. When he was in school, as a schoolboy, during initiation rites, at the recess hour, new students were required to improvise a speech on the most unlikely topic that could be dreamed up. Jari's performance became celebrated. The subject assigned to him was Turkestan. And this is what he said. So you're supposed to improvise a speech off the cuff. And this is what he comes up immediately with. Turkestan, just the subject I know best. The Orient, my friends. The unfathomable Orient. In a minute, he was talking about the Turks. Istanbul, Pierre Loti, Aziad. He was recalled to the subject. The subject, he said. What else am I talking about? Since when is a digression out of order? Cicero himself, in Pro Milone, The audience was submerged. The bell rang, and Jari concluded, "My friends, we have treated as best we could the first part of this vast subject. We shall take it up again tomorrow, at the point where this idiot bell is forcing us to stop." He did not take it up again. He made his literary debut like a wild animal entering the ring. And you gotta love that. As with diamonds, one must weigh one's words. During these years, Jari lived, so now he's moved to Paris, and he lived off the Boulevard de Port Royal at the foot of a dead-end alley, so narrow two people could not walk abreast. Handprints in blood decorated the walls of the spiral stairway, and in the tiny room he hung censers and crucifixes and kept owls, which he admired for the absurd shape of their beaks and their nocturnal habits resembling his own. One wonders indeed where it disappeared to. The only facts we have form a paltry debris. There is Jari's schoolboy boast about visiting brothels. There is one tale of his visiting card having been found by the police in the apartment of a fashionable Paris prostitute, Lugny Po. That he was the young theater director of the Theatre Le Ouvre who put on this play. Lugny Po states without comment that Jari came to the theater several times in the company of friends Oscar Wilde and Lord Douglas. And there is further evidence of homosexual proclivities. His writings refer to every variety of sexual behavior. From the beginning, he flaunts a violent misogyny and portrays women in the role of courtesans. In the various texts of Les Minutes de Sable Memorium, he wrote of homosexual love in a tone of dark meditation and distaste. There is some imbalance here, a wavering of emotional states which he has its roots deep in the turmoil of Jari's life. It is possible that he fell victim to psychological impotency in the presence of any woman he might have loved, and that he was at the same time drawn towards sexual inversion and solitary vice. This would partly illuminate the compulsive manner in which he exploited erotic themes in several of his books. This is funny. He says this to this woman. "Madame, your character is nothing to shout about, and like all of us, you are a negligible assemblage of atoms. But we will grant you one quality. You don't cling." Like all of us, you are a negligible assemblage of atoms. Funny. This guy was a knee slapper. How cool that he was running around Paris with Oscar Wilde and Lord Douglas. I think Lord Douglas was Bosie, Oscar Wilde's lover. So maybe Jari had some wild gay evenings with Oscar Wilde, one of the inventors of modern stand-up comedy, in my opinion, him and Mark Twain. Let's continue with the suicide by hallucination. So yeah, it's called that because he stayed fucked up all the time and he wanted to he wanted to become art. He wanted to become a character of his imagination. No one had been so close to him as his mother, and her death removed the only stabilizing force in his already unruly life. A few years later, he devoted one of his most passionately moving books, L'Amour Absolu, to the theme of maternal love, multiplied and transformed into an all-encompassing religious experience. Okay, so the guy might have been misogynistic and wrote about women as courtesans, but he loved his mom. Does that excuse it? Why are you pointing a finger at me? You should be upset that the president of the United States has sold us out to the Russians just because I can't pronounce a word here and there. Back off me. The events of 1893 to 1896 appear to have confirmed him in a slow and probably reasoned decision not to abandon his potashism. That's the half-brat, half-prodigy character that he becomes and is basically the character of Ubu Roy. But to carry it to a new level, to devote it the effort of imagination which he applied to his writing, these years contain a true conversion which compounded into one rash and unflagging exploit both his art and his life. It was in these years that, in addition to everything else, Jari began drinking. This explains, in part, the rapid disappearance of his inheritance. An unbelievable consumption of absinthe and ether at the end helped him do violence to his identity until his own personality dropped away. There it is. This unbelievable consumption of absinthe and ether at the end helped him do violence to his identity until his own personality dropped away. Like Rabelais wrote this character who was just like a fucking slob and an idiot. And there's a comparison with that being the inspiration of Ubu Roy. Like Rabelais, he proclaimed his faith in alcohol, calling it holy water, the essence of life, and my sacred herb. Anti-alcoholics are unfortunates in the grip of water, that terrible poison so solvent and corrosive that out of all substances it has been chosen for washings and scourings. And a drop of water added to a clear liquid like absinthe muddies it. That's hilarious, because all I drink is water now. Hilarious. And elsewhere he wrote, "We thought we had done once and for all with this question of alcoholism, and that all sensible people understood that the use, and even more, the abuse of fermented beverages is what distinguishes men from beasts." He drank defiantly and triumphantly. De Quincey had written that Confessions of a Hash Eater, or Opium Addict. Of an Opium Eater, I think it's called. I have it. De Quincey had a comparable addiction and equivalent boldness in calling his vice a virtue. Verlaine drank in secret. Nerval did not have to induce his intervals of insanity. Baudelaire, describing Poe and how he raised memory to power of a periodic dream, wrote a profoundly significant passage on the conscious functioning of the human mind. Let's skip that. Alcohol helped Jari achieve his fierce antic and sent him early to his grave. He must have first seen the results. So it was that through drink and hallucination, Jari converted himself into a new person, physically and mentally devoted to an artistic goal, a person in whom Jari, the man, spent the rest of his days dying. The question about the basic intentions of his life now begin to find their answers. He unlived his life. He abdicated his self in order to become another. And the culminating event of the process, which began with the loss of his mother, looks suspiciously like a perverse father identification. Jari's public behavior began to crystallize around a single figure whose presence had haunted him since the lycée at Rennes, that's the school he went to, and stayed with him in the army, and now usurped his speech and bearing. It was old Père Herb. He was a teacher of his, who the original play was written as a parody of his teacher named Herbert, Herbe. It was old Père Herb, rechristened with the infantile and immortal name of Ubu, in English, Ubu. Tricky, huh? By 1896, he had published 6 different fragments of Ubu texts, all modeled on the original schoolboy farces at René's. His systematic promotion of the character was well underway. In the spring of 1896, Paul Fort virtually commandeered from Jarry a full-length play called Ubu Roy and published it in the review, Le Livre d'Art, The Book of Art. At about the same time, Jarry read parts of the play to Gustav Kahn, the self-stylized inventor of Vers Libre, and several of his friends. Their enthusiastic reaction fired his secret ambitions. Ubu obsessed and possessed him totally, swallowed him whole. Therefore, it was as if, like Jonah, he could communicate only from inside the whale. He had found his other, the flesh of his hallucination. When Lugne Poe, the young director of the Théâtre Le Havre, asked Jarry to become secretary régisseur of the company, Jarry's hopes increased enormously. Okay, so he became like the something important. Jamier, swollen and commanding. Okay, that's what. Okay, yeah, this is the beginning of the. This is the opening of the play. Père Ubu was scandalous because the play starts with the word shit, merde, in French. And so the character, Jamier, swollen and commanding in his pear-shaped costume, but without a mask, despite Jarry's campaign, stepped forward to speak the opening line, a single word he had not known how to interpret the role until Lugne Poe had suggested he imitate the author's own voice and jerky, stylized gestures. Yeah, apparently Jarry had a really funny way of talking. He really emphasized things, and it was really like a machine gun. The way his speaking style was described is words coming out of his mouth like a machine gun. And he had these jerky, stylized gestures that he had invented. They weren't unconscious. The midget, Jarry, he was very short, truly sired the monster Ubu. In a voice like a hammer, Jamier pronounced an obscenity which Jarry had appropriated to himself by adding one letter. He added an extra R to merde. Merde, Jamier said. Shit. It was 15 minutes before the house could be silenced. So this is the stage that I stood on where this happened. The Théâtre Le Havre. I wanted to do my Netflix hour special there, but I don't know. Netflix hasn't given me the green light, and the theater, who knows if I'll ever get to play there again, but I fell in love with the place, and that's what made me want to read this book about this moment, because this one word on the opening night of the play of Ubu Roy, the place went apeshit, and it was 15 minutes before the house could be silenced. The Motte de Combronnere. Okay, this is a good little aside. And this is probably where the inspiration of that come from. One of Napoleon's officers at the Battle of Waterloo, General Cambronet, heard a report that one of his companies of the guards was surrounded. His heroic response of med became the Motte de Cambronet, I guess the thing that Cambronet said. Subsequently, the word achieved a paradoxical existence as an acceptable talisman of good luck, said to a friend going on a journey. Still, public utterance of the word was, in 1896, unthinkable. And that's when the premiere of Ubu Roy happened at Theatre La Ovra. So the Motte de Cambronay had done its work, the expression of the general Cambronay. The house was pandemonium. Those who had been lulled by Jari's opening speech were shocked awake. Several people walked out without hearing any more. The rest separated into two camps of desperately clapping enthusiasts and whistling scoffers. In Europe and the rest of the world, when people whistle, that's their booing. When people whistle, they're booing. Ferdinand Hérault in The Wings startled the audience into silence for a moment by turning up the house lights and catching people with their fists raised and standing on their seats. The actors waited patiently, beginning to believe that the roles had been reversed and they had come to watch a performance out front. Finally, Jumière, improvised a jig, he danced, and sprawled out on the promoter's box. His diversion restored enough order to allow the reaction to proceed to the next med. When the audience took over once more, the interruptions continued for the rest of the evening, while Père Ubu murdered his way to the throne of Poland, pillaged the country, was defeated by the king's son, aided by the Tsar's army, and fled cravenly to France, where he promised to perpetrate further enormities on the population. The story of Ubu Roy is no more than this. That's basically the premise, which I read to you before. The curtain rang down that night and the next on the only two performances of Ubu Roy until it was revived by Jumière in 1908. For the Theatre La Ovra, it was the catastrophe that made it famous. So there was only two performances. Man, if you ever get to go to Theatre La Ovra, hopefully to see me perform, I went back there. I loved that place so much. I had an early flight the next morning, and I sat out in front listening to John Spencer Blues Explosion Orange, the album. And I was just looking at the theater, and I kissed the edifice of this theater no less than 20 or 30 times. That's how much I loved this place and the theater. So William Butler Yeats, check this out. He was at this opening night, and he wrote about it. Also present in the house was a young Irishman by the name of William Butler Yeats. Despite a very limited knowledge of the language, his description of the performance is well worth repeating. I go to the first performance of Jari's Ubu Roy at the Theatre de la Ovra with Reimer, who had been so attractive to the girl in the bicycle costume. The audience shake their fists at one another, and Reimer whispers to me, "There are often duels after these performances," and explains to me what is happening on the stage. The players are supposed to be like dolls, toys, marionettes, and now they are all hopping like wooden frogs. And I can see for myself that the chief personage, who is some kind of king, carries for a scepter a brush of the kind that we use to clean a toilet. So the king, that's how farcical and absurdist this is. The king has a toilet brush for a scepter. Now you see why it inspired Dada and the absurdist theater and the surrealists. We have shouted for the play, but that night at the Hotel Corneille, I am very sad. For comedy, objectively, has displayed its growing power once more. I say, after Mallarmé, after Verlaine, after Moreau, after Puvis Chauvinese, after our own verse, after the faint mixed tints of candor, what more is possible? After us, the savage god. Wow. What more is possible after this? Five critics wrote favorable reviews. Those were the five mentioned in Jari's speech before the play started. And the rest of them tore it to shreds. Ten odd conservative critics, led by the ponderous Sarsi of Le Temps, denounced it as the limit of folly. One of them started his article, "Despite the late hour, I have just taken a shower." He felt dirty after the reading. Interesting. When the apprehensive house manager seated them, oh yeah, this is funny. So he becomes like the literary sensation of Paris. He dressed like shit. The bicycle was a brand new invention. And he rode that like a horse all over Paris. And he had pistols. You could have guns in France. He was such a funny guy. He gets invited to this opera. And the doorman, the usher, so he's a friend of the conductor, and the conductor is going to, wanted him to sit up front, but the usher saw them, and him and his friend, he thought they were, crappy looking ne'er-do-wells, so he brings him up to the balcony, and it's right as the opera's about to start. And when the apprehensive house manager seated them in the balcony instead of the orchestra, Jari took his revenge by complaining, just as the curtain was going up, in a raspy voice audible for the entire house, "I don't see why they allow the audience in the first three rows to come in carrying musical instruments." So he was kind of a funny smartass. Okay. In addition to being royally robed and lodged, Père Ubu had to be suitably... He had the bicycle, of course, became the royal bike... The bicycle, of course, became the royal vehicle. That which rolls, he called it, an external skeleton, which permits mankind to outstrip biological evolution in developing new modes of locomotion. Imagine the bicycle being brand new, and what a fabulous brand new way of getting around. Like where I live in Los Angeles, all over Los Angeles right now are these little scooters called birds, and you just see people ripping all over LA on these things. And it seems like a really fun way to get around. So imagine Paris when the bicycle was invented. And like, you don't have to take public transportation. You don't have to walk. You could, it was, Jari loved it. And it became part of his being. He rode his bicycle everywhere. Then there were his weapons. In those days of anarchistic assassinations, Jari made free with firearms and often sallied forth at night in Paris with a carbine over his shoulder and two pistols in his belt. Beneath the bravado lay the knowledge that there is no prohibition on arms openly displayed. So, basically, it was the open carry law, that if you displayed them openly, you could carry guns. A pedestrian who asked him one night for a light suddenly saw a gun belch red flame in front of his nose, while Jari murmured politely, "Voila." His marksmanship, his marksmanship with a stubby revolver was excellent, and he made a specialty of hunting spiders, frogs, and grasshoppers. The closest he came to injuring anyone was at the Falansteri, a summer house in Corbeil, rented cooperatively by the valets. Jari and several friends, they had all rented this place together. One day, Jari began shooting off the tops of the champagne bottles lined up against the wall that protected the landlady's neighboring garden. And that was scarcely designed to stop the bullets. The landlady came knocking in great perturbation to see Madame Rothschild and complain that the shots endangered her children who played in the garden. Père Ubu, overhearing, replied in full pomp, "If that should ever happen, madam, we should ourselves be delighted to get some new ones with you." We'll just make new kids if they get killed. The following year, the residents of the Falansteri had to found their community elsewhere. So they're trying to do like an artist commune, but they had pissed off the landlady with the gun. No such incidents were provoked by the most functional item of Jari's equipment, his fishing pole, on which he relied heavily for nourishment. He caught fish where no one else had any luck and lived in a miraculous world of true fish stories. A design by the sculptor Zed Keeney for a monument of Jari shows him simultaneously riding a bicycle, pointing a gun, writing in a notebook on the handlebars, and looking off into the sky. The whole thing lit from within. He met the world fully equipped. Everything in the world became a toy to him, as much as his bicycle and his pistols. The moment never comes in either his writing or his life when he had to clear his throat and say, "But seriously." He was always serious and always discovering a humor that is closer to metaphysics than to silliness. He can laugh with him. We can laugh with him and at him, but it is not easy to laugh him off. He rejected no part of himself or his environment and methodically transformed it all into an artificial world, the inverted dignity of Père Ubu. Such a transformation presupposes one absolute principle, the totality of human freedom. I can choose the color of my coat. I can choose not to wear a coat. I can choose, yet few men venture so far. I can choose not to be I. He can make the choice not to be himself. That's freedom. But for such absolute freedom, there is retribution. Like the sorcerer's apprentice, Jari was overwhelmed by his own power. Ubu acknowledges no affectations, no damnation. For him, nothing is sacred, not even, as in Faust, the clutch of his own mind. A distorted image of Faust, Ubu Jari, is engaged in the only act logically left for him, to perform, and that is self-destruction. Elevation by alcohol became his form of protracted suicide. That's why I stopped drinking. I felt like I was killing myself. Elevation by alcohol became his form of protracted suicide. Yet, while he was dying, he was at liberty. No worldly restraint could touch him. So here's this thing he would say when he would, these absurd things or outrageous spectacles, or if he had fucked up somehow, he had this expression that he would say, I'll skip trying to butcher the French pronunciation, but whenever something outrageous would happen or some big fuck up or whatever, his expression that he would always say was, "Isn't it lovely as literature?" Whenever he would see some outrageous spectacle, "Isn't it lovely as literature?" At 30, Jari had completed his best years enjoyed a unique notoriety in the literary world of Paris and was already looked up to by a new generation. With this, Père Ubu, who has earned his rest, is going to sleep. He believes that the brain, during decomposition, continues to function after death, and that its dreams are a paradise. So this is what he believed. That's why he stayed fucked up, so he could stay in this dreamlike paradise, and he believed that that's what death would be like, one continuous dream. But soon he could drink no more, for there was no more darkness for him, and no doubt, like Adam before the fall, he could see the dark. Okay, so now he's dead. The unstable compound of fable and fact that must pass as his life. The real Jari is as much a pretense as a personality because of the violent fusion he attempted of life and literature. We shall find him equally present in his writings. A biography of Jari ends by being about someone else, the inside-out person he created. In an almost frightening seizure, he became his pose. Jari offers one of the extreme cases in history of literary shit. He was an author becoming one of his own characters. That's what happened to him. He became one of his own characters. Okay, so I want to read you this last things about kind of the analysis of the play. So in Père Ubu, you know, he's the king. And he's got the army, and they defeat the Russians. And there's a corporal, and his name is Piss Sweet. In the unaccustomed atmosphere of absurdity, we laugh apprehensively. Yet the comic theme of slavish disobedience is merely a rear view with political commentary of the theme of confinement, solitude, and release, active living, which haunts Jari's most personal and obscure works. Where's the... Love is an act of no importance. It can be repeated indefinitely. Well, Jari may also have read the dream that Nerval relates in Aurelia. A goddess appears to him and says, "I am the same woman as Mary, the same woman as your mother, the same one. Also, you have always loved in different forms. With each of your misfortunes, I have dropped one of the masks which cover my face, and soon you will see me as I am." Dissatisfaction with the flesh does not leave a man relieved of his passions. From the very beginning, Jari's works portray man's struggle with his appetites. And that's fucking life on earth, isn't it, baby? Wow, I hope you've enjoyed this. This guy is such a character. I wish someone would make... you'd never see an English movie about him, but I'd love to see one in French. He's such an interesting guy. And the Picasso idolized him and imitated him is coming soon. And Charles Baudelaire, the famous poet who... wrote his most famous book is called The Flowers of Evil. Okay, here we go. Baudelaire had a theory of the comic, which took as its premise that an angel tripping over its wings would not be funny in the manner of a man slipping on a banana peel. Human laughter is intimately linked to the circumstance of our ancient fall, of our physical and moral degradation. Let us try, since the comic is an element of damnation and of diabolic origin, to consider an absolutely primitive soul, which, so to speak, has escaped nature's hands. Both are oblivious of human values. Ubu has only his appetites, which he displays like virtues. When we try to injure him with our laughter, satanic laughter, Baudelaire would call it, we discover that his behavior is so abject that we cannot reach him. He does not have traits of either a great hero or a great villain. He never deliberates. Can we really laugh at Ubu, at his character? It is doubtful, for he lacks the necessary vulnerability, the vestiges of original sin. Not without dread, we mock, rather, his childish innocence and primitive soul, and cannot harm him. He remains a threat because he can destroy at will, and the political horrors of the 20th century make the lesson disturbingly real. In his innocent obliviousness, however, Ubu cannot blaspheme. It is too sophisticated an activity for his elemental existence. Blasphemy indicates a further stage in Jari's literary development, for it presupposes something held sacred and therefore open to defilement. Strictly brought up as a Catholic, Jari gouted his faith to the limits of survival in his writings that mix irreverence and devoutness. Okay. Okay, here we go. The deplorable accident familiar to us all took place at the 12th turn. Jesus was in a dead heat at the time with the thieves. We know that he continued the race as an aviator, but this is another story. That's one of Jari's writings. So he was in a dead heat for crimes with the thieves that he was crucified with. And then he continued the race as an aviator. That was Jesus's ascent to heaven. So this is the dreamlike state of Alfred Jarry's creativity and his sense of humor. So that's kind of funny that he continues the race by becoming an aviator. And that's 1890s humor for you, baby. That's avant-garde Paris. Blasphemy is the manner in which Jari transformed religion into a sport. Just as the mechanical idea of the athletic record gave him the opportunity to victimize romantic love, the objection one might sustain to both these procedures would be in the name of good taste, and Jari had his gruff answer to that. He said categorically, "Screw good taste." Ubu's innocent evil and its rudimentary development into blasphemy belong to the world of the child man and represent a primitive attitude which first established Jari's reputation as a literary delinquent. Ubu and even L'Abbé Prout would not have outraged Rousseau, applied systematically to all things, including literature. The attitude became a method of humor based on logic, perpetually reversing its terms. A Negro fled from a bar in Paris without paying for his drinks. In his account, Jari affirms that, not at all a criminal, the man must have been an explorer from Africa, investigating European civilization, and caught without native currency. It is all a matter of point of view. When the army announced that it was about to equip its troops with a new rifle, Jari rose to the occasion in pompous opinion. We disapprove of the innocuousness of the military rifle for several reasons. A range exceeding our range of vision, such a high bullet velocity and small caliber as to produce no real wound, but only an unimpressive puncture. inability to produce smoke, etc. Needless to say, there has been no need to change the grass rifle, for it is a known fact in the Lebel 86, the repeating mechanism, if anyone is so foolish to try it, invariably jams, putting the rifle totally out of service. We assume that the inventor perfected this feature in order to render the arm useless to the enemy in event of our defeat. So the guy kind of twisted everything humorously. I like his brain, even though he was completely fucked up all the time. Just very interesting human being. Of course, there is more here than logical reversal. After reading 100 pages of such stuff, what strikes one is the attitude, the pose Jari holds. He writes deadpan. The solemn tone of his observations never cracks, no matter how hard he wants us to laugh. He never laughs with us. The true humorist, and here Jari is closer to Swift than to Rabelais, never participates in the immediate effects of his behavior. Jari's method of describing the world becomes more and more exhaustive examination of a restricted subject, taking every detail into account. Laughter, Jari wrote, is born out of the discovery of the contradictory. The statement implies a distinguishing between opposites which underlies all forms of the comic. But Jari could not be long content with observing this neat division of things. One of the ever-present tendencies in men of highly trained intellect has been that of travesty, the very discipline by which they live. Dodgson, mathematician and logician, has been easily survived by Lewis Carroll, who made playthings out of logic and common sense, a somewhat different kind of mind, which feels that its creative powers have not been fully explored, falls prey to drugs. There it is. A somewhat different kind of mind, which feels that its creative powers have not been fully explored, falls prey to drugs. De Quincey and Coleridge, Poe and Baudelaire. Jari seized both tendencies and through them attempted to convert his career into a sustained pattern of thought and behavior beyond literature and beyond laughter. He refused the contradictions of which he was so keenly aware and asserted the equivalence of all things. God is the point tangent to zero and infinity, he argued earnestly. No state of being excludes its opposite. Everything is not only possible but real. He was learned, and his learning came out backward to prove the preposterous and establish the paradoxical. He was semi-devout, and he blasphemed mightily. He was not clowning merely, he was observing a relentless method. At the same time, he prodded his imagination by constant drinking and by keeping himself in a semi-exalted state until there was no line between soberness and inebriation. Always be drunk. Soyez toujours ivre, which is French for always be drunk, exhorted Baudelaire. Jari obeyed literally. He was incapable of doing anything in moderation. Just as verbal restraint is not characteristic of his literary style. What astonished his contemporaries, who never tired of describing his personality and his extravagant actions, was the very refusal to observe limits, his consistent inconsistency. The universe of total hallucination ultimately absorbed all of Jari's life and writing. Primitive destructiveness was converted into absurd humor. Jari matches Poe, Edgar Allan Poe, in producing a reasoned scientific atmosphere for his extravagance. He jumps on our backs like an evil imp and will force us to see that there is meaning beyond the easy reach of comedy, as there is life beyond death. This kind of writing fixes tenaciously on an absurd situation until the first comic impression has been left far behind. His transformations finally obliterate the categories of literatures and the frontiers of life. Okay. What distinguishes Jari's career from an entire tradition of visionary writers, from Plotinus to Rimbaud, is, first of all, his quasi-suicidal attempt to achieve a new level of existence through literary... fusing his life and his art. Of almost equal importance is the fact that he pretended in both sentence and senses to express his experience in the form of science. Oh, okay. There was a reason I wanted to skip that. Okay. I call monster every original inexhaustible beauty. Monstrosity may well revolt us at first, but becomes beauty and a new form of humor. Okay, we are almost finished here, people. Are you with me? Can you handle a few more? Okay, this is such a great book. It's getting dark. I'm having a hard time seeing the light. I'm beginning to see the light. Only when the author has acquired sufficient experience to savor all its beauties. I'm sorry, this book will be published in its entirety only when the author has acquired sufficient experience to savor all its beauties. Such a statement attached to an unpublished text and the pains Jari took to put his manuscripts into safe hands make it clear that he was perfectly convinced not only of his own originality and importance, but also of the particular significance of pataphysics. That was his science that he came up with. Of seeing ugliness, seeing beauty in ugliness, and vice versa. He never did much more than name it and sketch it out in outlines, yet it stands as the final expression of all his attitudes, for it subsumes the principles of innocence and blasphemy, ambiguity and the absurd, the universal convertibility. They constitute the world within which he violated his own identity and exceeded the limits of literature. The disciplines of drink and pataphysics, however, were finally not enough to sustain total hallucination. Unlike Rousseau, not Satie, who could live to a ripe old age in a world of devotion and candor, Jari had to die in order to find the beauties of a universe supplementary to this one. His death at 34 put an end to a deliberately monstrous life, which, having transformed everything else, had no recourse but to transport itself elsewhere. So, wow. Ambiguity is best suited to poetry. At the swifter pace of prose, Jari exploited two principal styles: enumerative visual description laden with metaphor, and deft, flexible dialogue. Isn't that what we're all looking for? Deft, flexible dialogue? His narrative consists of series of descriptions, seldom speeded up to the point where we can forget the purely sensuous content of each scene. The description frequently verges on lushness, but a lushness which, at its best, arises not so much from the verbiage as from the elaborateness of the imagery. Okay. Here's an example. The river has a soft, fat face under the slapping of oars, a wrinkled neck, a clear blue skin touched with greenish down. It holds in its arms, against its heart, the little island, which has the shape of a chrysalid. The green-clad prairie goes to sleep. its head in the hollow between its shoulder and neck. Mm-mm-mm. And we are at the end of the pages that I want to read to you. How better to define... Okay. This is from what? This is from another play he did. Your watch has three hands. Why? That's the way it is here. My God, why three hands? Somehow it disturbs... My God, why three hands? Somehow it disturbs me. Nothing more natural and simple. Don't be upset. The first hand tells the hour. The second drags the minute along. And the third, never moving, points to the eternity of my indifference. Yeah, that was it. That's why I highlighted it. The third hand on his watch pointed to the eternity of my indifference. How better define Jari after all this than a great pataphysician? The word suggests both scientific rigor and farcical wand-waving, and permits him the combined qualities of comedian and wizard. Pataphysician. Jari bore poverty and scandal and loneliness by laughing at them. And one lesson of his life is that humor offers both a form of wisdom and a means of survival in a threatening world. It demands that we reckon with the realities of human nature and the world without falling into grimness and despair. The best comment on the attitude occurs in the non-technical passage of Freud's essay on wit, where he has been discussing the gallows humor of a condemned man who makes his last request on the scaffold for a kerchief to keep his neck warm. We must say that there is something like greatness of soul in this black humor, in this clinging to the usual nature and in deviating from that which would overthrow and drive this nature into despair. All of us can take fright, but it requires greatness of soul to laugh at the moment when not merely life, but humanity itself is endangered. Endangered not because Jari behaved scandalously, but because his behavior is latent in all of us. Okay, now this is the end. You guys have been very patient little listeners. I gently kiss your foreheads wherever you're at. And I wanted to give a shout out to the Patreon people and a lot of people who continue to give money to support this podcast. But I'll do that another episode. This has been a long one. I hope you've enjoyed it. And this is just this guy Alfred Jari has been blowing me away, and I wanted you to know about him. And this is the last paragraph I will read you about this amazing human being who blurred the lines between art, comedy, dreams, hallucination, and theater and writing. Jari applied these theatrical principles not only to Ubu, a man turned inside out with his basest appetites hung on the outside, but to himself also. He lived a contortion and twisted himself inside out. His soul was, after all, an assemblage of tics, mask, eccentricity, gallows humor, and greatness of soul are merely different names for his chosen attitude. The two guiding principles of his career, the absurd ideas systemized in pataphysics and the theatrical ideas about formalized gesture and masks, led to a single principle of conversion. Anything can be its opposite. He demonstrates that outrageous truth with the robustness of Rabelais, the spiritual truculence of Lautrement, and the cool rationality of Poe. The world is his hallucination. Having ventured so far, Jari frequently becomes inaccessible. That is to be expected. The true source of astonishment is that the apparently disparate elements of his career should finally mesh. His biography, his legend, and his literary work are so organically combined that, strange to say, no sustained effort to isolate one from the other aids in explaining him. Like the plates of a battery pulled apart, they cannot carry separately the charge which they accumulate when they almost touch. Jari is a devilishly modern figure, unbearable and engaging, who transformed his life into something as lovely as literature, and attempted to strike a new balance between seriousness and humor. Apollinaire wrote wisely when he called him the last sublime Dubosch of the Renaissance. The last sublime Dubochy of the Renaissance. Wow. Okay. That's got to be good. He was a debauched, sublime human being, and he of the Renaissance. That has been today's episode, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to find everything I can on Ubu Roy, maybe YouTube or something has, maybe I can find a performance of it that has English subtitles. But the image of Alfred Jarry riding his bicycle around Paris with a carbine rifle over his shoulder and two pistols in his belt, and Ubu Roy, the king with the toilet brush, are pretty happy images for summer. And I hope you're having a great summer where you're at. I no longer drink alcohol, so I will not be refreshing myself with booze. When I say goodbye to you now, I will be heading directly to my refrigerator to pull out the chocolate chip ice cream that I'm going to reward myself with. And I hope you can reward yourself with some lovely ice cream. I'm looking west out my window. It's twilight. It's dusk. The sun just went down over the Hollywood Hills. And like I said at the beginning of the podcast, it's an interesting time in history. I think America is in big fucking trouble. And it's going to take a big effort of... it's like the emperor's new clothes, man. The people don't want to say that the emperor is naked, but there's something really fucked up going on with our president and him selling out our country. And the sun is going down now, and it's summer, and there's a lot of reasons to be happy. Thinking about France winning the World Cup, the craziness of Alfred Jarry, the innocent beauty of the painter Rousseau. And I highly recommend this book, The Banquet Years, by Roger Shattuck, and the origins of the avant-garde in France from 1885 to World War I. And that's also when the Eiffel Tower went up. So joy be upon you, my friends. And that's all we have for today. And thanks for listening. I really, really appreciate it. Mwah! I blow you a kiss. Shalom, amigos. E amigas. I'm talking about you.